Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, make sure you have pen and paper because I'm going to explain to you something that you weren't aware of, but that you should be aware of. It will demonstrate the degree of propaganda and preparation that those who are bringing about the New World Order are engaged in order to prepare the public. And a good portion of it, ladies and gentlemen, is aimed directly at the children of the world. If you took your children to see The Lion King, you will be especially interested in tonight's broadcast. For tonight, I'm going to give you the true meaning of that movie, and I'm going to tell you exactly what was taught to your children. Even though they may not realize it, even though they may not understand it at their tender age, and even though most of the parents in the world who have attended the showing of The Lion King had no idea whatsoever what it was that they were watching, tonight you're going to find out. And when you do find out, I can assure you, most of you will be angry. Walt Disney was a 33rd degree Freemason of the Scottish Rite. Disneyland in Anaheim, California has an address of 1313 Anaheim Boulevard. Unless you understand the symbolic meaning of the mysteries and the symbology of Revenge of the Templars, you may not give too much importance to that address, but those of us who know do. Walt Disney was a very famous Anglophile who was in bed with the FBI and the intelligence community and spied for most of his life on his fellow movie makers in Hollywood. We know that in 1958, for 1 year, there was a colloquium of the greatest scientific minds in the United States, gathered over several meetings during that year to discuss the exploration and colonization of the Moon and Mars. At every one of those meetings were representatives of the Walt Disney Studios. Now, you may not really understand what this is all about yet, but I can assure you, before tonight is over, you'll understand at least a part of it.
Thank you.
I'm going to read some verses to you, ladies and gentlemen, from Genesis chapter 4. I want you to pay close attention, and I want you to understand that I don't necessarily subscribe to everything that you're going to hear tonight as my personal beliefs. I'm just going to tell you the message in The Lion King. Whether you believe it or not is up to you. But the people who are bringing about the New World Order believe it, I can assure you. The opposing forces engaged in this battle all agree that they will have a one-world government. The only point of contention is which one of these opposing forces will sit upon the throne of the world. One believes that they are protecting and will hold forth a king descended from the house of David and thus related directly by blood to Jesus Christ. He will hold the titles of the King of Jerusalem and Holy Roman Emperor. He will be a direct descendant of the Merovingian bloodline of the kings of France. One of the others is to believe to be the direct bloodline descendants of Cain. And they plan to seat their king upon the throne of the world. And then, of course, there is the Vatican, which I guarantee you will be one or the other of the first two when all the dust has settled. I read from chapter 4 of Genesis, and just so you'll understand the difference in names, this is from the Restoration of Original Sacred Name Bible. Not because I think this Bible is any better than any other, but because in preparation for this show, this was the Bible that I grabbed off the shelf. And it's exactly the same as every other Bible that most of you are familiar with, except for one thing. It has revised the names to reflect the original pronunciation and meaning. I'm going to start in chapter 4, Genesis, verse 8. And Cain said unto Abel his brother, Let us go into the field. And it came to pass, when they were in the field, that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and slew him. Then said Yahweh unto Cain, Where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. The keeper of my brother am I? And he said, What hast thou done? With a voice, the shed blood of thy brother is crying out to me from the ground. Now therefore, accursed art thou from the ground, which hath opened her mouth to receive the shed blood of thy brother at thy hand. Though thou till the ground, it shall not go on to give its vigor to thee. A wanderer and a fugitive shalt thou be in the earth. And Cain said unto Yahweh, Greater is my punishment than I can bear. Lo, thou hast driven me out this day from off the face of the ground, and from thy face shall I be hid. So shall I become a wanderer and a fugitive in the earth, and it shall come to pass, whosoever findeth me will slay me. And Yahweh said to him, Not so. Whosoever slayeth Cain, sevenfold shall it be avenged. So Yahweh set for Cain a sign that none finding him should smite him. So Cain went forth from the presence of Yahweh and dwelt in the land of Nod, eastward of Eden. And that's where I stop at this portion. And I, in the interest of time, will explain to you some of the rest of the story. According to the Bible, one of the direct descendants of Cain, was a man named Nimrod. Nimrod, ladies and gentlemen, set up the first civilization, became the first king in what was known as the Golden Age. He built the Tower of Babel. He brought together all the different religions and melded them with politics. He was indeed the first king. He had a college in Babylon, for that was the city that he built. This college was the first lodge of what is now known as Freemasonry. Indeed, if you read the books written by prominent Freemasons throughout the history of Freemasonry, they refer to Nimrod as the first Grand Master of the First Lodge, and that he loved Freemasons and had many hundred Freemasons under his rule. In Genesis chapter 49, verse 9, listen carefully, as I quote, "A lion's whelp is Judah. From the prey, my son, hast thou come up. He hath stooped, hath crouched as a lion, or as a lioness. Who shall rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the commander's staff from between his feet, until that he come in as a Shiloh, and his be the obedience of the peoples. Binding to the vine his ass, and to the choice vines his ass's colt, he hath washed in wine his raiment, and in the blood of grapes his mantle. Darker his eyes than wine, whiter his teeth than milk." And that is where I stop reading there. In The Lion King, the first scene is the rising sun in the east. The rising sun in the east. And the sky is golden, setting the stage for the golden age of the ancient peoples, the ancient city, the ancient kingdom, which all the secret societies say that they will return the world to very shortly. The Golden Age, the age that in reality, ladies and gentlemen, never existed, but it exists in their minds, and it's a way to manipulate these people to work toward that worldly utopian dream. And you see, all the animals are coming from everywhere. All the different animals denoting the different races to pay homage at Pride Rock. All throughout the history of all the religions, there is the rock that was present at the foundation of the world. Upon this rock I build my church. Under the throne of the Queen of England, there is a rock. The importance of Pride Rock is evident. Pride Rock is in the east, for indeed the sun rises behind it. In the east sits the master of the lodge. Pride Rock is in the shape of a pyramid. It also represents the ziggurat, or the Tower of Babel. And a great commotion is heard. Something is happening. And all of the animals from the plains of Africa gather around this rock. Remember at Mecca, all of the Islamic followers go to Mecca to march in circles, circumambulate around a rock. It seems that a baby is born, a new prince, a lion cub that will eventually become the king. This lion cub is handed over to what appears to be a baboon or a monkey, but it is not, I assure you. And this baboon or this monkey does not represent the black race, but rather represents the Eastern influence in religion. In this case, as in all cases with these people, is very akin to theosophy. And this is borne out later in the movie, as you shall soon see. The king, the Lion King, does not take his newly born cub and hold it up for all to see. Instead, he hands the king the newborn cub, the new king, of course, will not be king until the old lion is dead, over to this monkey, who represents the priesthood. And this is significant. What they're saying is that the king really does not hold the power, for he handed his son to the priest. The monkey, of course, is the priest. The priest is the one who marches to the end of the rock and holds the lion cub up for all to see. And remember, the priest represents the religions of the East. One of the recognition keys to Freemasons is, if someone suspects you're a Freemason, they might ask you if you're a traveling man. Do you do much traveling? If you don't know the proper response, they'll know that you're not a Freemason, are a member of the Rose Cross Order, are many of the others who exist under many different names, but at the top, all are the same. But if you are, you would answer, yes, as a matter of fact, I have done some traveling in the East. And you might be asked at that point, what is it that you seek? Why are you traveling in the East? And the answer would be to find the source of illumination. So this is significant. You then realize that the brother of the king did not attend this ceremony, and he is to be admonished for this. Who is this brother? Well, you notice that the Lion King, not the cub, but the older lion, is golden, beautiful, magnificent, strong. His brother is dark, weak, cowardly, and impotent. His brother also has something very significant in this film, a scar over his left eye. And indeed, it is the mark of Cain, according to these people who believe all of these things. And Cain is jealous of his brother, who is the king, saying that he should have been the king. He has all the brains. His brother, the king, has all the brawn and doesn't deserve it. Is that correct? Well, it doesn't matter. That's what the movie portrays. If you know anything about the Arthurian legends, the legends of the Holy Grail, you know that this dark lion also represents the Fisher King, who was wounded in the thigh, or, as some accounts have it, between the thighs. And you know that he is doomed if he ever takes the seat. Oh, yes. This movie is full of symbolism, and it tells the old story, and it tells what's happening in the world today and what is to come. It is a message, and it's being taught to your children, and you're the ones who took them to see it. Now remember, Pride Rock is in the East, for the sun rose behind it. It is the seat of the Master of the Lodge. And we quickly learn that the land in the north is barren, and no one lives there, or at least we're led to believe, for it is an evil place. And in the lodge, no one sits in the north. For the north is said to be the place of darkness, and in the movie, this land in the north is the place of darkness. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm not reading from a script, I'm telling you what I know from out of my head. Scar, the dark lion, the lion which represents Cain, sends the newborn cub by deception and trickery off into the north, where he almost loses his life. And the north indeed is fearful and evil. It is the land wherein dwells the hyenas. The hyenas are the enemies of the lions, and indeed of the entire kingdom. And when you hear these lions talking, you immediately discern, not lions, I'm sorry, hyenas. When you hear these hyenas talking, you immediately discern that they represent the black and Hispanic races. There's no doubt about it, ladies and gentlemen. And the intent is clear. They represent the black and Hispanic races, and because they dwell in the north, the place of darkness, the movie conveys to your children that they're evil and bad and dangerous and ignorant and stupid, as they are portrayed in this movie. Well, the young lion barely escapes with his life, but he does escape. And Scar makes a pact, with the hyenas. He tells them that if they will side with him, he will kill the king, his brother, and he will rule in his stead. And the hyenas, of course, agree to this because he promises them that they will never be hungry again. Now, one of the things that you must understand is that the golden age is portrayed brilliantly here. The kingdom is full of lush growth vegetation. All of the animals are happy and fat. There is no strife in the kingdom except the ill will between the Lion King and his brother Scar. Which is to say that as the world existed then was the best that has ever been, which is another lie, for this nation, the United States of America, is, or was, I should say, until recently, the best that had ever been. I hope you understand the significance of what you're learning and the significance of what was taught to your children as they sat watching The Lion King. You see a romance blossom between the young lion and a young lioness that promises fulfillment, promises a fertile kingdom, promises that the future will be just as good as the present. Indeed, the birth of the young lion in the beginning of the movie is an expression of the overabundance, the cornucopia of Babylon, the fertility of the land and of the kingdom, plenty for all. And what happens? What happens, ladies and gentlemen, is incredible, for it follows exactly the same old story that has existed throughout the history of the world, that has been used over and over again to manipulate peoples and nations and kingdoms, and divide and conquer, and to promise things that cannot be delivered to those who will faithfully follow the manipulators, the puppet masters, those who pull the strings. This is all being taught to your children. The hyenas and Scar set up the situation that will result in the death of the Lion King. And, As Scar has planned it, the death of the young lion also. Under a pretext, another lie, another deception, Scar takes the young lion out into a gorge and sets him on a rock. Again, there is the rock. Sets him up on a rock under a tree. Under a tree. You see, in those days, all sacrifices were formed upon a rock, under a tree. Sometimes it was an elm, sometimes it was an oak, sometimes it was something else. And if you know the old story of Isis and Osiris, then you know that the acacia tree was one of them. But the young lion is placed upon a rock under a tree. And the hyenas have assembled the herds at the head of the gorge. And of course, there is no way out. Scar then goes to tell the Lion King that his son is in danger. And tells him where he's at. And the Lion King runs off to save his son from whatever danger there is. And then the stampede is started. Up the gorge comes the huge herd of the plains animals back into this box canyon with no way out. Don't go away. You'll hear the rest soon. Yes, lions are growing. It's about time you understood the significance of all of this. It wasn't too long ago that I told you that you would begin to see more and more pyramids, more and more obelisks, more and more triangles cropping up everywhere. And of course, that has happened. And after tonight, you will know why the lion, the magnificent lion, with his paws over the entrance of the MGM Grand Hotel in Las Vegas, faces directly the Luxor. For the two are part of the same mystery. And now you will begin to see more and more lions cropping up, lions rampant, lions lying, lions this, lions that, lions everything. But let us go back to the gorge, where the Lion King is rushing madly to rescue his son and is caught up in the stampede. The lion at this point represents the sun, which dies at sunset. Osiris, who was killed by his brother Typhon, also called Set, Osiris represented the sun. The lion also represents Abel. He represents the sacrificed king. He represents John F. Kennedy, who was slain at the point where the sun was at the most high point, in the temple of the sun in Dealey Plaza, in the presence of an obelisk and a reflecting pool in the four corners. Of a architectural rendering similar to Stonehenge. Dealey Plaza, shaped like the truncated pyramid with the capstone missing. The eye, indeed, is the underpass under the railroad overpass. All of these things have been portrayed and represented and foretold throughout the history of the world by every different people and every different religion. It is the old cosmology. The Lion King is trampled to death just about. His son escapes, and his son watches as the Lion King valiantly tries one last time to escape from the stampede, and as he is hanging by his claws, literally, from the edge of the gorge, his brother Scar knocks him off. Cain slays Abel. The sun sets. Osiris is killed by his brother Typhon,
the august body of the mystery. Have you ever heard a senator stand up and talk about this august body? Anyone who makes that statement represents the lineage in this story, if you believe it. Remember, I'm telling you the meaning of all this. It does not necessarily mean that I believe it or that you should believe it. It's just what they believe. And if they believe it and they have the power, it will affect us, I can assure you. The Lion King falls down and is trampled by the herd. The young lion, thinking that he is the cause of his father's death, realizing there's no way he can explain this to his mother, the widow, and he is the widow's son, he leaves the kingdom. In the Bible and in history, it's represented by Seth, who conquers Babylon with an army and scatters Nimrod's college across the world. Across the world. It's also represented by the scattering of the tribes of Israel. The slain king represents the lost word, that which was lost, the doctrine. The widow represents the church. The church. The young lion who leaves the kingdom represents the scattered college. He is, in fact, the full body of initiates. Where does he go, folks? He goes out into the world lonely, without companions, without a place to go, without anyone to belong to. And he wanders until he finds two other outcasts. One, a little lemur. If you don't know what a lemur is, look it up in an animal book or an encyclopedia and you'll see a picture of one. A little lemur that talks exactly like a Jewish man from New York is imagined to talk and is parodied in many different ways. And I'm not saying that it's a correct parody, but it is the way this little lemur talks. And the other is a warthog, which represents all the downtrodden, ugly outcast, the nerds, the people who have no place in the world, the handicapped. And they form a union. They come together. Of course, the little Jewish lemur represents the Kabbalah influence on the mysteries. The young lion king represents the full body of initiates. He is the child Horus. And the warthog represents all those who do not feel any allegiance or loyalty to any other body who have joined this union, hoping that in the end they will be vindicated and will have their place in the sun. In the sun. And they wander about in the wilderness, seeking the promised land. Oh, yes, ladies and gentlemen, this is really something. And, of course, they are persecuted and attacked. And the young lion fights off the attackers and protects the other two. This traditionally has been the Kingdom of England, Great Britain, which is represented by a lion. This outcast trio represents British Israelism. The Queen of England is called by the mysteries the Queen of Babylon, and it's about time you knew that also. And they come across the young lioness, and he falls in love, this young lion. And she keeps telling him, remember who you are. And the monkey shows up and keeps telling him, remember who you are. And you hear it every night on WWCR following this broadcast and on many other broadcasts where some rabid preacher is exhorting to the white race, remember who you are. You are the real Israelites. The world belongs to you. Listen, after I sign off tonight, you will hear it, ladies and gentlemen, I assure you. Remember who you are. And this monkey king keeps, monkey priest, I should say, and the young lioness keep urging him to go back and claim his rightful kingship. For he is the true king, they tell him. He is the descendant of the dead king. And they tell him that the dead king lives on in him. And they tell him to look into a reflecting pool to see. And there he is looking back at the young lion, his father, in himself. For he is the genetic duplication representing the white race. And what's being taught to your children, ladies and gentlemen, and shame on you for taking them to see these things which you have not assessed the meaning of prior. And the king says, no, I cannot because of my past. I cannot, I'm afraid. They'll know who I am and they'll know what I did. Talking about the bad things that existed in Babylon, he does not want to reveal who he is. And the monkey king represents the philosophy of the East, not the monkey king. I don't know why I keep saying that. The monkey priest, representing the religious philosophy of the East, smacks him upside the head with his staff, and the lion king says, ouch, ouch, why did you do that? He says, it doesn't matter, it's in your past. And all of a sudden, the young king understands. And so he says he will go back. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, remember when this pact was made between Scar, the dark lion, and the hyenas, the dark lion representing Cain, and the hyenas representing the race of Cain, when they made this pact, and when the dark lion ascends to the throne of the kingdom, it happens on the pinnacle of an obelisk. And the crescent moon surrounds his head. And this branch of the mysteries, ladies and gentlemen, represents Marxism, communism, the Soviet Union, all of these things. The French Grand Orient Lodge of Freemasonry. And while this young lion was out wandering in the wilderness, with his two friends representing the Jewish people and the warthog. Actually doesn't represent the Jewish people because the Jewish people don't know any more than the Protestant people or anyone else, but it does represent the Jewish branch of the mysteries, which is B'nai B'rith and the Kabbalah. Don't go out and persecute Jews because they're no different than any of you, believe me. Back at the ranch, the kingdom is dying. All of the green trees die. All of the grass dies. The dark lion representing Cain, also representing the fisher king who is wounded between the thighs, has laid waste to the kingdom. What was his sin, ladies and gentlemen? His sin was the mixing of the races, according to these people. Remember, Walt Disney was a very famous Anglophile. It was many years before a black person was ever hired by Disneyland or any of Walt Disney's organizations or businesses. There was no food. The pastures dried up. The trees died. The kingdom became as the north, barren and wasted. Barren and wasted. And the young lion king
sings a song about he cannot wait to become the king and set everything straight. And he goes back, and there's a tremendous battle between the young king and Scar and the hyenas and the young Jewish lemur and the warthog and some other allies that showed up at the last moment. And there you see the fires raging, burning everywhere. And that is why you saw fire in Waco. That's why you saw fire with the MOVE group in Philadelphia. That's why you saw fire with the Symbionese Liberation Army when they were burned. That's why you saw fire during the Inquisition years as they burned their enemies at the stake. What is represented here is evil on all sides involved. The poor, ignorant sheeple of the world who don't know what this means or how the battle is being waged or what it's all about are always the casualties. But the young lion wins. And when he wins, he marries the lioness that he fell in love with. And the trees sprout and the plain is lush with grass and all the animals are happy and have the food. And you can see they're all separated according to kind. They're no longer mixed. And the kingdom blossoms. The sun rises again and the new age is reborn as the old golden age returned to the earth. And the warthog and the little lemur representing the Jews are happy finally and have their place in the sun, exalted. And is teaching the children that there is looming before them the dawn of a new age, a return to the golden age. Where the races will once again be separated. And the Tower of Babel, represented by Pride Rock, will be rebuilt in the east. And all of this under your noses. You took your children to see this movie, not understanding exactly what it was that you were watching. But now you know, and now there's no excuse, and you should explain all this to your children and explain to them what a terrible thing it is. I don't care which side of this you're on, both sides represent evil. Evil incarnate. They are liars, they are deceivers, they are manipulators. And they manipulate with old stories made up many, many years ago to pacify wandering tribes in the desert and keep their lineage pure. Because in those days it was necessary, ladies and gentlemen, it is no longer necessary. But it is used as a tool of manipulation. No one was around in those ancient days to tell who killed who or what's what or who's descended from where. And I'm not telling you that your Bible is wrong. I am telling you that all of this has been used to manipulate and control people throughout the history of the world. And that's what you need to understand. And until you understand it and stop being manipulated by it, you will always be one of the innocent victims in this battle. For you are not part of the power structure. And you are of no consequence to any of these people on either side. They care not whether you live or die or what your suffering is. They only care that they mount the throne of power. That they destroy all existing nations, all existing religions, and create a one-world totalitarian socialist government which they will rule. To you it is known as the beast. The number of the beast is 666, which represents all those initiates who have gone through the 3 degrees in 6 acts. The 3 degrees of the mysteries
the mystery religion of Babylon. The wars between the Vatican, between Scarlet, and between the Beast. And they all agree that there will be a one-world government. The only point of contention is who will sit upon the throne of the world. If you want to play their game and buy into their deceptions and help them achieve this, you will always be their slave, no matter what side you are on and no matter who is the victor. And you will make their shoes, and you will plow their fields, and you will play their football games for their amusement. And you will keep your mouth shut on certain subjects. And you will do as you are told. Or you will just very simply, ladies and gentlemen, cease to exist. The brainwashing of your children has been going on for quite some time, right under your nose, and you don't even know it. And it's about time you learned it, and it's about time you do something about it. And understand this, the brainwashing is strong. It is strong. And it plays on the emotions. And it feels good. It is such a great deception that even the elect shall be deceived. Don't fall for it. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you can sleep well tonight, though I doubt it. God bless you, and God save this republic.